Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to tell the story about how modern color entered our lives about 160 years ago. It changed our perception of color, our palette, our fashions, our vocabulary, everything. I'm going to illustrate my talk with my botanical paintings. I hope through learning more about the origin and history of color that you'll come to have a greater appreciation of what you see. I lived in Japan, where silk painting is a high art, and now I live in Switzerland, where, along with watches, Switzerland was once one of the world's largest producers of silk fabric. In Basel, I live next door to the Alsace, which was also once a textile-producing powerhouse. I got caught up in the magnificent textile history of this region, and I made this quilt. The quilt covers over two centuries, but not to worry, I will save the most exciting three decades for you today. And these kind of quilts are an American folk tradition. I intend for my pieces to be hung on the wall, and when I start, I always start with white silk. My interest in synthetic dyes originates with my artwork. In 1856, William Henry Perkin discovered the first successful man-made coal tar-based dye, an early example of better living through chemistry that went on to herald the development of several classes of dyes over time. He studied at London's prestigious Royal College of Chemistry under August Wilhelm von Hoffman, who from Germany. Chemistry was not long out of the age of alchemy. Professor Hoffman's personal research interest was in coal tar. It's the industrial waste from gaslight that was the then modern form of lighting. It was the Easter holidays, and Perkin was fooling around at home in his family's home workshop, and at Hoffman's suggestion, he was using an aniline of coal tar benzene, and he discovered a precipitate that would color silk a pleasant shade of purple. So, he had just turned 19 years old, he patents his invention, he drops out of school, he convinces his father to go into business with him, and they begin manufacturing this purple dye. Lucky for them, purple was not a color that was easy to achieve using natural dyes. Previous to this time, brilliant colors had been reserved for royalty and the prosperous. However, the popularity of purple skyrocketed when Princess Victoria and Empress Eugenie wore the colors. London ladies of fashion renamed the color mauve, a new word in our vocabulary. And soon, thanks to the less expensive fashion color, everybody was able to dress themselves in the new purple or mauve. When there's a good idea and money to be made, many will copy it. Perkin and Sons profited handsomely from their monopoly in Britain, but on the continent, French and German dyers quickly copied mauve. Germans had to work harder. They didn't have strong patent legislation, and they had to work harder at production efficiencies and establish better marketing. Up until this time, France had dominated the natural dye market. However, the next most important dye was discovered by a Frenchman, Emmanuel Vergang, and he called it fuchsine. The world had never seen a color quite so brilliant. It was immediately much more popular than mauve. Lyon-based producers quickly secured the rights and began production. They kept the prices high and chased patent infringers. French dyers suffered from the monopoly held by this firm called La Fuchine, and many French dyers went back to using natural dyes, and there was an exodus of dyers to Germany and Switzerland. Switzerland didn't have patent law at the time, and Basel had lots of investors. There was really a lot of money involved. For example, this man, Alexandre Clavel. He left Lyon having purchased the rights to produce fuchsine in Basel for what would be, in today's money, $4.9 million. So in the next 10 years, all throughout our region, we begin to see firms springing up that produce dyes and their intermediates. And you may recognize some of these companies that are ancestors of companies we know today, and maybe a few of you work for them or related to them. I am forever grateful for fuchsia. Fuchsia is the essential for the frame of this piece I made. It's a large quilt. Fuchsia is not a color that's obtainable using natural dyes. Back to Professor Hoffman. He was Perkin's former teacher, and he's now the world's most important dye chemist. He's also working as a champion and cheerleader for the understanding of the science behind new discoveries. And he also discovers an important dye called Hoffman's violets. At this time, there's a lot of things happening in chemistry, a chain of key discoveries. And it's a very exciting time in chemistry. Hoffman also returns to his native Germany. At this time, German firms are setting up the first research and development labs to find that next important color and to work towards medicines. And the two Karls work at unraveling the chemical composition of the natural red dye, alizarin, from the rose madder plant, and they create its synthesis. This is the first ever of a synthesis of a relatively complex, naturally occurring organic material. So now, chemistry is mimicking or copying nature. And I am forever grateful for red, and I made this fabric. Couldn't have done it without red. Indigo from fermented leaves is the only natural dye that can make a true blue. Up until the turn of the century, it was a major source of British wealth, and London traders controlled the world supply. So as you can imagine, German manufacturers, armed with new, robust national patent legislation and the world's best chemistry, were very keen to create a synthesis. And so eventually, Adolf von Bayer creates a synthetic indigo. It was very complex science, and it still took a real long time to get up to production. And at this stage, we see that large production facilities and lots of investment is needed to make synthetic indigo. So we see the emergence of German cartels that offer much more worldwide market control than patent monopolies. And by World War I, most of the indigo in the world is produced by Germany and its synthetic indigo. During the war, most countries didn't want to dye their soldiers' uniforms with German dye, and Swiss products replaced German ones. As you can tell, I concentrate on the magical and romantic aspects of the story, but I should just take a couple seconds to mention some of the disruptive technology. The many people that worked in the natural dye industry in France and India lost their livelihoods. The early dyes didn't always behave like we might want them to. And thirdly, making dyes and dyeing textiles requires vast quantities of water, leading to releases of wastewater. Nature's self-cleaning capacity seldom, if ever, can take care of the problem. And we begin to see in the 1950s complex industrial treatment systems emerge. I use the ancestors of these dyes. I made this fabric, and I thank you very much for letting me share my enthusiasm for color and the history of this region. Thank you.